I think we are happy, we dance, we sing, because sometimes it's better to laugh to keep from crying.
It is true that she has had a tempestuous life. Men have floated in and out of it, some as gloomy specters, some as rogues, some as vital effervescent boilers. She has known and lived the violence and sordidness and stink of township life. She is drunk and found in vino veritas the tot of truth. People have called her all sorts of names, those who thought they were entitled to cast the first stone. But somehow, none of these things stuck. If she has been a she-devil, that's because she's a hell of a woman. So, a lot has been made recently about the it girl's place in the 21st century, in the age of the social media panopticon that makes everyone and anyone famous. Who are these icons, these stars, who perfectly encapsulate the time and the culture? Who has that undeniable charm and charisma that dominates every conversation, that can suck the air out of a room, that draws you in time after time? Which girl sets the trends, have actual influence, move people to action and feeling? I recently visited the library, and yes, you should too. The books are literally free, and I happened upon this book by Nakedi Rabane, which is Beauty, A Black Perspective, which has gotten me thinking about South Africa's it girls. I know for my older sister, she had Bonang Matheba and Kanyimbao, which isn't to say that they're not still like relevant right now. And I think for my mother, it probably was Brenda, Fassie and Lebo, Mathosa. And if we recognize that a key characteristic of any it girl is also embodying aspects of the it girls before her, then I have to ask, who was South Africa's first, the icon, the legend, the moment? In short, I've just been wondering, who's mommy? If you've ever seen any iconography from 20th century South Africa, you'll probably have a good idea what the answer is, but I'm gonna need you to keep it to yourself for now. Shh, no spoilers. But for the rest of you, just know that the quintessential it girl wasn't just model, singer, or actress. She wasn't just a beauty and a fashion icon, but like the very best it girls, she was her time's personification of pain and pleasure, freedom and incarceration, promise and denial. And like most women throughout history, she's a myth first. That's what makes her so enticing, of course. She's a blank canvas for the male gaze's anxieties, fears, lust, and disgust. She is the moment, like literally capturing a time and a place that exists more in an imagined ideal than in the actual real physical world. Part one, the femme fatale.
The 50s were a never-ending dance in the rain.
To paint this picture, let's take it back to the 1950s, basically the roaring 20s for Black South Africa. Prohibition, gangsters, jazz music, short skirts, and a dangerous feminine mystique. This ecstasy of modern Black life is best epitomized by the long-departed Drum Magazine and Sophiatown, Johannesburg. I don't think either require an introduction. They're practically required reading in the South African lexicon, and I'm pretty sure you'd get shot in the head if you went to any party in Brum and you couldn't like name one drum cover. And we remember Drum now as the first Black lifestyle magazine, which practically just set the tone, pace, and style for urban and township life in the 20th century, establishing a school of capital B, as in Black writers, journalists, artists, photographers, and beauty queens who've influenced film, theater, music, literature, and culture to this day. Like, to this day. I can't overemphasize how significant Drum was to like our cultural lexicon. And as for Sophiatown, like, duh. The suburb was established in 1905, intended to be white only, but being adjacent to the city's toilet and dumping ground made it the place for the unprecedented migration of Africans to urban areas and to the city. Its equivalents were Lady Selborne in Pretoria, which we now know as Africville, and District 6 in Cape Town, which was like an almost utopia where people of different races could mix and interact and create an island from apartheid and shape a country in their own image, especially as they were increasingly denied that. Drum and Sophiatown are one and the same. You can't even attempt to discuss one without the other. They're so intrinsically interlinked, they're so tied together. They are this forever and ever. In Drum, as in Sophiatown, was the internal and external conflict of the modern African, even as we know it now in like present day, a clash between rural life with its traditions and the temptations and urgency of a modernizing world that sought to erase those very traditions and leave the African behind. Both had their heyday in the 50s. It's even referred to as the Drum Decade. And what was also occurring at this time was the emergence of a new character, a new figure, the urban African woman, the modern African woman, a new kind of girl. And boy, did she shake the frickin' table! As industrializing colonial societies drew African men into the modern wage economy of the mines and urban centers, they by implication drew African men into modernity, or the future. This was while leaving behind African women who formed the bulk of rural peasantry, thereby pushing African women into tradition, or the past.
Oh, I came to Joburg, the golden city. Oh, why did I come here for? I'm a long way from home in Joburg City, so far away from my core.
Her newfound mobility and desire for agency wasn't just a threat to white supremacy and nationalism, but to the authority and the position of the African black male. In 1958, drum writer Kan Temba described this new woman. 50 years ago, she was content to sit in the sunshine of mud walls and on dung-smeared floors. Now, this creature was talking back, was catty and gossipy. She now talks about those unheard-of things: divorce, abortion, feminine rights, and mere males. You sat back and looked in wonder at this woman, not long out of the loincloth, now draped in python gowns and making her point with a long cigarette holder.
Drum isn't just a magazine, man. It is the people who made it. The oddballs, the screwballs, the ladies' men, the ladies.
The pages, stories, and covers of Drum are obsessed with women, to be quite frank. The publication sought to define Africa for Africans, and this included crafting or documenting, but really crafting African femininity. And I've kind of found a lot of it to be rather horny and maybe even depraved, but I guess this obsession with beautiful girls and their hips and their curves and their legs arose out of a desire to prove the beauty of blackness, especially in a time when apartheid relegated everything that was black and native as undesirable and unrefined. It was this, you know, this proof of concept that like black was beautiful, that black was valid, that black was important and desirable. But at the same time, it also hoped to control this femininity, this womanliness. The urban African woman's assertiveness, her independence, her newfound sexuality, her ability to speak and say things they didn't agree with, was a challenge to the one crumb of force and ownership that black men had in this time. That little bit of power that they had was over black women, who were the only other people below them on the ladder. However, the same assertiveness, independence, and sexuality, and willingness and wantingness to talk and be heard and to be seen was also enthralling and captivating too, right? Like, I've always said, that fear and lust are just two sides of the same coin. There's nothing hotter and sexier and wetter than the things that absolutely terrify you. And what made these women so terrifying, so scary, so lethal, so deadly, I don't know why I said it like that, but so deadly, is that they would come to symbolize the temptations and the allure of the city, but also the same chains that kept black men bound to the white man and white supremacy. While on one hand, these women were like a reprieve from static rural life and its responsibilities, like say the wife and kids you might have abandoned because of all of the alcohol and partying and freedom you could enjoy in the city. On the other hand, these men also came to resent these women and hate them and find them disgusting because of how they could use their feminine wiles to drive them to debt, to drive them to jealousy and fits of passion and anger, and that they would have to keep slaving away for whitey so that they could probably woo and keep these city girls. Dorothy Driver writes, "Like jazz, a quite different form of female sexuality entered drum's pages, active rather than passive, wild rather than tame, promiscuous rather than domestic, black rather than white, in dialogue, sometimes with male sexuality rather than subordinated and owned." And no one had a more dangerous allure. No one understood the power of being looked at. No one wielded the sexuality better than or more prominently than the figure of the Sophiatown jazz singer. Enter Dolly Rathebe, Miriam Makeba, and Dorothy Masuka, the It Girls. If you guessed it, then like you can collect your prize. In each of them, we can glean the zeitgeist of 20th century South Africa. And even though women were taking the political stage in the 50s, they were still primarily relegated to the binaries of either housewife or city girl, i.e. pure, docile, loving Madonna, or immoral, lethal slut. Even though Dorothy, Dolly, Miriam fulfilled these typical roles of jazz singer, beauty queen, actress, and model, people to be looked at and also to be signs of moral like abjection and, you know, the sex and the sin of the city, they never really neatly fit into this Madonna slut binary. Sure, they weren't like the angelic mothers and nurses we would see in the 1956 Women's March, but they weren't just the silky-voiced eye candy that was there to rot the male brain and distract the African man from the things that really, really mattered, like his family and fighting for the revolution. These women were rebellious and they were cheeky. They fashioned their own images. They wrote their own songs. They could be political and angry, but they could also be romantic and yearning. They were fully articulated dolls, snipping at their own puppet strings. They're my 20th century foxes. Part 2. The doll. Dolly Rathebe was the first African female movie star, making her debut in 1949's African Gym, or as its most well-known, Gym Comes to Joburg. This was the first feature-length film to come out of South Africa, so it goes to say that Dolly is intrinsic to the foundation of local cinema and celebrity. Like, she built all of that. The movie follows Jim, a rural man who moves to Johannesburg in hopes of hitting it big in the city of gold. Upon arrival, he's mugged. A Johannesburg initiation at this point. Like, do you really live in Joburg if you've never just been mugged at least twice?
Also, he's so dramatic. He literally only got mugged once. Like, be for fucking real, bro.
And after his mugging, he meets Julie, played by Dolly, who helps him launch a career as a jazz singer.
Like the place, dear.
Sorry, I'm editing and I'm fucking cackling because I need someone to give me like a really real answer why everyone in like these old movies talks like this. It's so,
yes, sure.
Like,
you want the job, boy?
Yes, sir.
Now, this is a very brief summary of this movie, which I haven't actually seen since I was in high school, and I can't find it anywhere online to stream. But I do know that Jim comes to Joburg has now become a certified trope in South African media. Even at the time, several black people and black men were influenced by the movie's promise of success and glamour and mobility and fortune that could be found in the city of gold. And they found themselves migrating to come and like achieve this dream. And you can see that that idea has still held a lot of steam and a lot of merit, especially now that Joburg is firmly established as South Africa's economic capital. It is the center for any kind of dream you'd want to achieve. If you want to make it in South Africa, it is our African dream with a home to it.
Like, I'm a Johannes Goldberg.
Yeah.
The film wasn't a financial success, but it did become a cult favorite, and that was primarily due to Dolly's presence in the film. Her performance was so enigmatic and captivating that her name even became township slang for all right, or like a response to someone asking you how you're doing, you know, like everything's Dolly, it's all Dolly. Like, she was just so iconic and she was so mesmerizing to the public that, you know, she was associated with like doing well. Initially, the producers were looking for a light-skinned woman to take the role, but Dolly's audition, or when she was scouted, was so mesmerizing that they completely changed course. And I just really love how her star power like evaded the pencil test. And it's really significant to me, at least, to see that superstardom in this time, or the inception of black celebrity, lied in the beauty of an unambiguous dark-skinned black woman who was actually for once recognized and appreciated and revered and celebrated for her talent. In the character of Julie, Dolly came to represent the promise of city life. A distinctly feminine call that could uplift any Joe Soap from rural nobody to urban connoisseur. This was also the first time black women would be depicted outside of the role of domestic servitude, and thus for women, Dolly represented the upward mobility and glamour awaiting them. They just need to take it and possibly imitate her to capture it. She was the genesis of the modern myth that Ken Temba describes in Drum.
She's the modern African miss, wrote Ken Temba. She's city slick and sophisticated. With silky bras, chinin stockings, and jet black hair. She's arrived in style, and men had better watch out.
Basically, she does what she wants, and she looks cool doing it. Following her film debut, she was put on the cover of Drum. This was shot by the German-born photographer Jürgen Schadeberg? Featuring Dolly in an itsy bitsy teeny weeny yellow polka dot bikini at Johannesburg Mine Dumps, for which they were both arrested. Since Dolly and Jürgen were a black man and a white woman, and one of them being kind of half naked, the apartheid police assumed that they were having an interracial relationship, which I don't think I have to remind anyone was illegal according to the Immorality Act of the time. But getting arrested only further cemented Dolly's legendary status. In this book right here, like, Eddie Rabani notes that run-ins with the law and like criminal offenses were total clout points, stating, "The underworld at that time was in a sense doing its bit towards the struggle by showing no respect for the law. Since the law was unjust, anyone who flouted it and got the better of it was admirable in the eyes of the black community." And I think it's also interesting that, like, even across the world and in modern times, anytime women get arrested, it always adds to like their mystique and their legend and their fame. And this definitely applied to Dolly.
But the lady was the huskiest, furriest, shadiest, bluesiest mess of them all was Dolly Rathebe.
For a while, Dolly enjoyed a really illustrious career, and she would come to inspire her later contemporaries and or successes like Miriam Makeba and Dorothy Masuka. She was renowned for her husky voice, the way she commanded the stage, how she moved her body, the way she dressed, the way she spoke, how she looked, and of course her personal life, which occupied many of Drum's pages. Rabani also adds that everything Dolly did was news. She was without a doubt a superstar.
Thank you.
In fact, there was a 10-page series on her life and her loves. In February 1955, drum journalist Todd Machikiza wrote an article on Dolly, the doll Rathebe, titled What They Say About Dolly, which included, she doesn't wear the same dress for 2 days. Women go to shows to see what she's wearing. For men, it's not what she wears, but how she wears it. She was exactly everything men wanted and what women wanted to be, and probably also who women wanted to be with, if not just being her. And when it comes to what she wore, it seems to be very in line with the 50s traditional focus on femininity and formality. You know, nipped in waists, matching accessories, an ever-present hourglass figure, always womanly, always elegant, always delicate. She even apparently like abhorred seeing women in trousers, which yes, in this time was seen as like masculine and overly casual, and perhaps even a little bit slutty. And while she liked for men to be men, she also embodied a lot of contradictory, stereotypically masculine traits. You know, she was said to take to the stage like a boxer in the ring. She spoke back. She was aggressive sometimes. And she also reportedly could handle her own in the many abductions and assaults that would befall jazz singers in this period. It seems to me that like female performers kind of were living in the Wild West at this time, and it became really beneficial for any kind of glamorous girl to have a gangster at her side to curb this danger, which is just like so yikes. I hope you guys like my makeup. I was kind of going for like a 50s look, and I even followed a tutorial from the time. And I think I should share one of those these days because they're so funny.
Here is Miss Roundface without any makeup or hairstyling whatsoever. Her face is drab, and she simply wouldn't be fair to herself or her family if she continued to look like this.
Dolly would become the first black ambassador for Mac cigarettes, front popular jazz age bands like the Harlem Swingsters, and even inspire the drum advice column Dear Dolly, where several readers would write in with their romantic problems to the worldly and experienced image of Dolly. Of course, she didn't actually write any of the correspondence, and I think even a man was behind a lot of the letters, but her name and her image was enough to get people to buy in. And that sort of agony aunt format is still really referred to as Dear Dolly in the South African context, and it's really famous to this day. And despite the fact that she was known as the African Billie Holiday or the Black Marilyn Monroe, it's interesting that she didn't actually record any music in this time, like actually hitting the studio and like telling the DJ to play something funky. In fact, like there isn't any sort of like existing record from the 50s and 60s of her music. Sure, she performed a lot and her music was well known and really appreciated, but her actual like physically recorded music only came from the late 80s and the 90s. Her career would unfortunately hit a roadblock in the late 50s, early 60s period. The apartheid government obviously made very quick work of destroying any black art and culture and joy in this time. Sophiatown itself was officially destroyed in 1955 when 2,000 armed policemen forcibly removed the black residents to designated black areas like Meadowlands, Soweto. By 1959, many of her fellow artists and companions and friends would be banished to exile due to censorship and an angered apartheid government that was becoming increasingly violent and aggressive. She was one of the only ones to remain behind in South Africa. While her peers were able to find stardom and refuge overseas, it became increasingly difficult for Dolly to be Dolly, to perform, as an 8 p.m. curfew was established and the city's cultural center was gone. So she moved to Cape Town, to the Langa Township, I believe, and she even ran a shebeen there for a few years. And she did have a brief comeback in the mid-60s, but this didn't last. The age of sort of Sophiatown and this black renaissance and the jazz age was over, and with that, so was her career. Her next performance wouldn't happen until the 90s, at the end of apartheid and the inauguration of democracy. And in The Magic and Meaning of Dolly Rathebe, Zikona Balela writes, Rathebe was more than just a star. Her appearance and work were inventing a world in which black people could see themselves reflected as glamorous and far removed from the shells of human beings they were constructed as by the apartheid project.
The blues singer, Dolly Rather.
No other country in the world has embraced American jazz with more enthusiasm than South Africa. Nobody knows exactly why, although it might be because we saw in Black America the mirror image of ourselves. South Africa's whites had rejected us. That stripped us of our land, of our dignity, of our past. We were slaves in the land of our births, as African Americans were in theirs.
Part 3, Africa is a country. So Dolly essentially set the example or the blueprint for what female celebrity would be in this time, establishing how, like, the career trajectory, the way that they would dress, how they could perform, the success they could find. But if Dolly walked, it was really so that Miriam Makeba could run. She was 4 years younger than Dolly, born on the 4th of March, 1932, a Pisces. Also, if anyone cares, Dolly was an Aries, which tells you everything you need to know about why she was a bona fide hot girl, just like me. Miriam's life actually began in a jail cell. At just 18 days old, her mother was arrested for illegally brewing alcohol, which is a really common occupation and source of income and livelihood for a woman in this time.
The children shout from the streets as they see police cars coming to raid their homes for one thing or another. They say, "Kauleza, mama," which simply means, "Hurry, mama, please, please don't let them catch you."
Miriam would later describe herself as not being a political singer, just someone who sang about her experiences and that they happened to connect with the experiences of other Africans. But I can't imagine that this really early run-in with the police state didn't influence her later activism and the way she blended music and civil rights together. Out of all of the songstresses and beauty queens from Sophiatown, Miriam is arguably the most famous, or was the most famous. She conquered the world stage, performed before world leaders and presidents, received a Grammy Award, and became the first African woman to have a number one hit with Pata Pata. Once she was in exile from the late 60s onwards, she helped alert the world about South Africa, bringing awareness and light to the situation back home, even testifying against the apartheid government before the United Nations, and going on to court the attention, admiration, and support of several African leaders from Tanzania to Kenya to Ghana to Guinea to, oh God, like literally everywhere. She was widespread. She was influential.
I'm influential.
And she was so influential that I think she was a really big part in helping to establish the pan-African sentiment we associate with the, like, late 20th century independence movements across the continent. And I think her work would also help assist later South African activists and revolutionaries when it came to turning to other African countries for support during the resistance movement, which I think totally makes her wholly deserving of the Mama Africa title she later earned. But what I also think really captured the world's attention when it came to Miriam was her look. Of course, like, her music and her voice and her talent are undeniable, but her preference for short, natural hair, African prints, and beaded jewelry came to define the aesthetic of the emerging Black consciousness and Black is beautiful movements of the 70s. This more Afrocentric appearance only really took place or came to fruition once she left South Africa. First, because she was going on tour for in the UK for the hit theatrical production of King Kong, which, by the way, isn't the movie about the ape, but actually a really great play about a boxer that can't find anywhere online. It was a huge hit in the UK, by the way, and once she was there, she was scouted by the American singer Harry Belafonte, with whom she created a joint album for which she would earn her Grammy Award for, which, yeah. And even apparently on the night of her first performance with him, the team had styled her with her hair straight, and she immediately just said, not a chance, went to the bathroom, washed that shit off, which I really love for her. And you can see also that in her first memoir, she reveals how critical she was of this possible fetishization of her and this need to westernize her. And also that as an African woman, she would have been commodified for her uniqueness and like exotic nature in this time. And she was gonna like show herself on her own terms. And I like to imagine that this approach to the way she presented herself was either an attempt to hold on to her culture, especially as she would soon become a woman without a state when the apartheid government would declare her persona non grata, or that also perhaps she recognized the importance of setting herself apart on the global stage, not only from a PR's perspective, but how she could really play a significant role in bringing South Africa to the world and the world to South Africa. This Mama Africa look was also notably different from how she began her career in South Africa, which is why I suspect it was a really calculated and smart decision. Her first film appearance is a very brief stint in 1957's Come Back to Africa, which, by the way, is available for streaming, but it's really expensive. And it's also where this very iconic image from her comes from, in which we see her interrupt a group of men who are discussing politics and the state of the nation. And then she's asked to sing for them.
Hey, sit next to Miriam. What's she? Just a song, one song.
Oh my god, I could totally stop this guy, what the hell?
She doesn't contribute to the conversation. She isn't invited to share her opinions and debate and argue with the men, but just to sit there in that form-fitting green dress and sing a really pretty tune. Just a pretty girl in a pretty dress, respectful and subordinate. The ideal African young lady. Rabanne goes on to define African beauty ideals as not only determined by physical attributes. In traditional society, good character has always been considered integral to the notion of beauty. No matter how beautiful a girl might be in appearance, she was always expected to be a hard worker, as well as respectful of the elders of her culture. I think this is also what enthralled so many African people to her all across the continent. This more modest, traditional aesthetic also became indicative of representing her people and her culture in the right way, which isn't to say that this was what it was for Miriam, but definitely how it was interpreted, especially since she hardly wore any makeup, or at least gave off the appearance of being makeup free. And obviously this isn't much of a surprise considering that like makeup products for black people didn't exist until Rihanna launched Fenty in 2017. And that for most African women up until recently, they mostly had to rely on natural ingredients and things like sunlight soap and Vaseline to maintain their appearance, especially because they wouldn't have been catered for in the makeup aisle anyway. Plus, when you look at a lot of like historical beauty practices for the majority of Africans, not to blanket everyone as a single culture or people, there seems to be a much greater emphasis on hairstyling, on jewelry, and like other kinds of body modification, which just enhanced by clear skin, and not say the sort of European mode of like rosy cheeks and ruby red lips. Moreover, at this time, there was also a lot of contention in the black community when it came to the use of cosmetics, particularly in African black communities. Traditionalists and the religious and the conservative viewed makeup as indicative of promiscuity, and it was the realm of prostitutes. Or worse, it was a show of people wanting to look white. Zanele Tutu points out that even up to 1994, it was very difficult to sell skin products and makeup to the black market. Those things were associated with loose girls. And also considering how one of her contemporaries and also Miriam's ex-husband, Hugh Masekela, would also very notoriously state that he wouldn't even talk to a black woman in a weave, you can imagine how this like full embrace of this one ideal of traditional Africanness was really celebrated and welcomed by a lot of people across the continent, particularly the male and the patriarchal. All of a sudden, people who never knew I had been in America since 1959 are asking me to be on their television shows and play at their concert halls in 1967. In the discotheques, they have invented a new dance called the pata pata. Couples dance apart and they then reach out and touch each other. I go to Argentina for a concert, and everywhere I travel in South America, they are singing my song. Miriam was a pop star, a hit. She was, like, she was Mama Africa. She was everything at one point. And African Americans especially went crazy for this African queen. I think they were actually the ones to dub her Mama Africa. And as the late 60s was beginning, the Black Consciousness Movement, Miriam really held a lot of influence over that 70s embrace of natural hair and afros and dashikis and this idea of returning to the motherland, which we now obviously kind of roll our eyes at. At the time, she said, "I see other Black women imitate my style, which is no style at all, but just letting our hair be itself. They call it the Afro look." In 1968, she married the controversial Black Panther activist Stokely Carmichael, further bonding her to the civil rights and liberation movements of Black people across the world. Like, these two were just the ultimate power couple. And I think for African Americans in particular, Miriam wasn't just an introduction to African culture, but as a piece in the conversation puts it, the possibilities of what they could become expressed through song, dance, dress, language, and ideology. And she was a really powerful asset when Stokely Carmichael would go out and do his speeches and his activism, to have this like African queen, this very symbol of African womanhood by his side. Unfortunately, this marriage wasn't as great for her and her swelling African career. You can imagine that marrying a Black Panther put a bit of a target on her back. White America stopped listening to her music altogether, deciding that she was a danger and a threat to their values. And the CIA and the FBI began bugging her apartment and placing her under heavy surveillance to such an extent that she and Stokely eventually had to move to Guinea for like some peace and some safety and calm. I can't imagine that if she had stayed in America for any longer that she wouldn't have ended. And from her time in Guinea, her US visa was revoked and she was separated from Stokely in 1978. Not really clear as to why, but I can imagine living on the run isn't really good for a marriage. And while the 70s and 80s were otherwise really good periods in her career, where she was able to tour the continent, build these Pan-African relationships, and essentially become the first African pop star, she was a woman without a state, a woman who couldn't go home. When her mother passed, she was still denied entry into South Africa. Her music and her image was banned across the country. It was even illegal to privately own a photograph of her. And by the early 80s, her only daughter would pass away. In the same time, she battled with alcohol abuse and she would get diagnosed with cervical cancer. She wouldn't return to South Africa until the 1990s upon the request and insistence of Nelson Mandela. And I can only imagine what it must have been like to come back to her home and see how it was changed in the 30 years or so that she was gone. And also hopefully that she knew how intrinsic she was to that change without even having to physically be there and without having to say anything there. You know, she was a femme fatale in the sense that her femininity, her womanliness, her sense of independence and her progressiveness was a direct sucker punch to everything the apartheid government had tried to enforce, and part of what had led to its downfall.
In the olden days, the young Xhosa maidens often sang this song in praise of the young Xhosa braves, as they would get ready to go out into battle. In other words, it's a song of encouragement. We call it Cholingo.
I kept my culture. I kept the music of my roots. Through my music, I became this voice and image of Africa and the people without even realizing. Part 4. A girl is a gun. So Miriam would say, "I'm not a political singer. I don't know what the word means. People think I consciously decided to tell the world what's happening in South Africa. No, I was singing about my life. And in South Africa, we always sang about what was happening to us, especially the things that hurt us." So Miriam's number one hit song, the one that earned her all of that accolade and fame and prestige, Pata Pata, was actually written by another South African songstress, Dorothy Masuka, where Dolly would embody and represent the urban African woman and the African man's anxiety over her mobility and sexuality and independence, coupled with his deep, deep horniness for it. And Miriam would come to represent an entire continent and its cultural contributions and the civil rights movement and the Black is Beautiful movement. Dorothy Masuka, I think, then was the embodiment of the African woman as a rock, the African woman entering politics, the first riot girl, the truest riot girl if there ever was one. And Dorothy's politicization started very early in life, which isn't unlike Dolly or Miriam's, but I think she was a rather unique case. She was born in 1935 to a Zambian mother Father. And a Zulu mother. And they had both settled in Zimbabwe, but had to quickly move to South Africa in her early life because of Dorothy's ill health. And unsurprisingly, but very disappointingly, even with her success, she would experience xenophobia from the same Black people that she wrote songs for. Like, they would dance to her music, but still call her all kinds of slurs because she was Zambian, Zimbabwean, foreign. She began her life in Catholic school, but quickly dropped out to pursue music, eventually encountering the same wrought relationship most Black people will come to have with Christianity.
We as Christians believe in the development of the non-white people, and we certainly try to develop them as far as possible by building their churches, giving, subsidizing them in their church work, and we are also trying to give them leadership where they want it. And our experience is that these people prefer to be left in their own church.
She said, "I had started to question what it could possibly mean that a living God who sees all things could allow Black people to be treated like we were being treated. It was hard for me to see if there was something else." Unlike her contemporaries, Dolly and Miriam, Dorothy was explicitly political in her music. Not just that she was the kind of person singing about love and romance and the Black experience and that the person was political, but that she was like outright calling people out and taking names. She was also one of the few singers of this time who was both a composer and a songwriter. She became the first artist in South Africa to call out an apartheid minister by name in her song Dr. Malang, which was about D.F. Malang, if you couldn't put that together. She sang about the assassination of Patrice Lumumba. She sang about the Defiance campaign and her support of it. She sang about the Black woman and their relationship with the police over illegal brewing, and obviously talking about how those cops are damn dirty pigs. And interestingly, not many Black women in the drum decade actually had a lot of control of the mic, let alone the pen. She really occupied a unique space in being able to write her own music and speak from her own voice. And even though the images and the stories and the pages of African media at this time was occupied with women, you'll be very hard pressed to find and name and see the Black female photographers and writers contributing to culture in this time.
The African woman has suddenly become the focal point of resistance to the nationalist government.
If you watch Have You Seen Drum recently, the 1989 film, which by the way is available to stream on iTunes and isn't expensive or hard to find, it's about the publication's contributions to culture, politics, and history. You'll notice that out of the two women who speak in this documentary, only one of them is Black. I just think that's, yeah. And at that, Drum, just like Bantu World, the other prominent Black lifestyle magazine of this time, often had male writers writing to, at, and for women. The urban African woman's perceived promiscuity and her wanton sexuality were so concerning to the Black elite of this time that the pages of Drum and Bantu World and other publications soon became the place where these men got to perform sort of a ventriloquist act on women, writing as women or supposedly from female experiences to present the respectable and acceptable standards for how African women were to behave in order to maintain their idea of their role in society. Which, even while celebrating their achievements in music, sports, and culture, the role was always to be traditionally feminine and subservient and in service to the male gaze. These magazines were ironically the first to start offering women's pages, but the mic was always squarely in their hands. This wasn't a real woman's voice that you would find from these pages. So Dorothy then utilizing her pen like a knife wasn't just groundbreaking in that she was political and activist, but it was also indicative of how Black women were breaking out of the sphere of domestic life and servitude, whether or not the male gaze was willing to accept it. You know, you strike a woman. In 1956, 20,000 women would march to the union buildings in Pretoria to protest the institution of past laws for women. So for those of you who don't know, African men up until this period, and actually for a really long time, were required to carry passports, or dompasses as they would become to be known, which gave details of the holder's identity, employment, place of legal residence, payment of taxes, and if applicable, whether or not they were permitted to be in certain urban areas. The point of this was to control the movement of Africans in white areas, and it was very common for men to be jailed for indeterminate stretches of time over any small offense concerning their passes or lack thereof. The point was to make sure that they understood that they were prisoners in their own country. The land wasn't theirs to roam freely. And as the late 40s and early 50s saw the influx of women to the city, the 1952 Native Laws Land Act sought to extend this restriction to them. God, that's a mouthful. Dora Tamana, a founding member of the Federation of South African Women, had declared, "We women will never carry these passes. These passes make the road even narrower for us. We have seen unemployment, lack of accommodation, and families broken because of passes. We have seen it with our men. Who will look after our children when we go to jail for a small technical offense? Not having a pass." The notable figures of the women's movement were Lillian Ngoyi, Helen Joseph, Rahima Musa, and Sophie Williams de Brain. They were textile factory workers, nurses, and retail associates, positioning themselves as maternal figures protesting the breakdown of family life and doing their work for the children.
The government have ridiculed us for mourning. They don't understand, or say they don't understand, why women should stand mourning a constitution. They think we would be much better staying at home and looking after our children.
And obviously you both disagree.
Well, we think that we do look after our children.
We feel very much that this is looking after our children, because after all, it's the future of our children we're worried about. If I had no children, I don't think my interest would be nearly as keen.
Yet, even while towing the line of female respectability in this period, they weren't immune, just like Dorothy, to being objectified and sexualized by their male counterparts. As their male counterparts, they were like protesting and communalizing and collectivizing for, you know what I mean? Like, the brothers will always betray you. Mick Samuelson writes, "Drum's representation of housewives, sportswomen, and political women always emphasized their femininity and involved a characteristic mixture of idealization, anxiety, and contempt." While Dorothy was crooning about pain, suffering, and injustice, you know, this shared Black experience, one drum writer would spend a little bit too much time discussing a striped dress she wore with wide lines that seemed to run down her whole body, neck to hem, round her curves, under the belt, round her cute waist, into the men's eyes. "Yes, man!" exclamation point. Like, I could hear him drooling. He noted that she had exciting bedroom eyes that you'd think she wanted every man around. "But those eyes, gents, those eyes are as fully booked as a December train." Then going on to describe how Dorothy basically belonged to one man, Simon Petter, who owned two shops, two butchers, two cars, and a lot of dough. Which, like, oh my god, just let her cook! At the same time, Winnie Madikizela was also emerging as a political figure, and not dissimilarly from Dolly, Miriam, and Dorothy, she also had a go at the beauty pageant circuit for a time. Not very long time, but for a brief time. I won't go like too into it, but the 50s and 60s, and even the 70s and 80s, were really mad about beauty pageants.
It was Drum got the cuties up on stage, turning a posse of pretty faces into a parade of beauty queens. And the strong men flexed their muscles and winked and blinked at the beauties.
There was a contest for just about everything. Miss Africa South, Miss Soweto, Miss Mini Universe, Miss Legs, Miss Brigade, Miss Bantu World. If you could come up with something, there was a pageant for it. Like, it was a festival and orgy of beauty queens and bikini contests, I'm sure. And I cover a little bit of this history in my video on South African beauty pageants when I discuss Miss South Africa. But this is all just to note that there was a real, like, beauty queen to superstar pipeline that we really don't see as much of today. Beauty queens were monumental starting points for the careers of singers and actresses, but they also were pretty helpful to political careers as well. Winnie obviously didn't remain in the pageant circuit for very long. I think she only also ever earned like one title, and neither did Dorothy, but it does go to show how much emphasis was placed on their looks and beauty while they were trying to champion women's rights or whatever. But also, it also goes to show how like cunning and clever and powerful these women were, and that they took advantage of how much people wanted to look at them, essentially appropriating their own objectification and using that to further their own agendas and causes. The anti-apartheid protests actually began in 1950, but the largest demonstration took place on 9 August 1956, for which we celebrate Women's Day now in South Africa. And it saw women of all races, occupations, and backgrounds taking to the streets in one of the greatest shows of female solidarity we've ever had in this country. And I like the idea of talking about solidarity because I think that's a recurring theme when it also comes to all of the figures in the jazz age. Of course, it's very famously known that the jazz age was a really great time for male solidarity, when you have groups like the Harlem Swingsters and the African Ink Spots, as well as the camaraderie people like Hugh Masekela was able to enjoy with his male figures and counterparts and contemporaries. But I also really enjoyed that it was a really great time for sorority and sisterhood. Dolly, Miriam, and Dorothy were actually friends, and together they were outperforming their male counterparts on the charts, on the stages. And what's most remarkable to me is through all of that, how much they looked after each other, how much they supported each other, how much they gave to each other, how much they built each other. They mentored and they taught each other, and they actually like physically protected each other. I mentioned earlier how there was this lurking shadow of danger for female performers that had required them to befriend and entertain gangsters for protection. Stabbing, kidnapping, and assaults of several kinds was very routine in their experience, and Dorothy has shared how the women before her had actually really taken it upon themselves to shield her from this male predatory, you know, encroaching, especially as she was one of the youngest performers on any of these tours, and they made sure to protect her from all of these creepy dudes that meant to do her harm. And I think that's really beautiful. In her later years, she would also tell the Mail and Guardian how it was Miriam, Dolly, and Tandi Klassen who had seen her off when she went into exile, how they sent her baskets of fruit and pictures from home, how they were present for the birth and naming of her children, how they sang with her in times of despair, brought her warm porridge when she experienced grief and loss, and they were able to maintain these lifelong friendships. And I think that was really important because exile wasn't as fruitful for Dorothy as it was for Miriam. After releasing the song Lumamba in 1961, the authorities seized all of her records and she was forced to flee, first to her home of Zimbabwe, which was then known as Rhodesia, and then to Zambia, where she ended up working as a flight attendant for several years. She wouldn't be welcomed back to South Africa for about 31 years, which is an insane amount of time to spend away from any place. "They should have destroyed me instead," she said, "because I can still sing." Rabana says of her, "Dorothy was a very popular and prominent icon of her time and of those from whom Miriam learned her style, but she remained largely forgotten until recently when all of the exiles returned in the early 1990s. So Dorothy probably had the largest discography out of her contemporaries. obviously a lot of her records and like the archives have been lost to time, but it is suspected that her discography borders on something like over 100 songs and records cumulatively. But we do know that by her late teens, she had 30 singles, all of which were certified bangers, all chart toppers, went double platinum, at least in my parents' and my grandparents' house, I know. She also sang in a multitude of languages, Shona, Ndebele, Zulu, English, Swahili, Bemba, and many, many more. And similarly to Miriam, she was able to become this connecting thread for different African walks of life, showing this unity in the African experience and the struggle, and really helping people come together, at least over her, their enjoyment of her music. And I can't find out exactly everything that she got up to in exile. In her Mail and Guardian interview, she's very quick to end any conversation over her political activity at this time. And I suspect it wasn't a very pleasant experience, and probably very traumatic considering how female activists are treated. But she does also reveal that her success and her fame weren't equal to any sort of financial security. Even though she received several accolades and awards, she was often paid in dresses and little bits of pocket money or spending money for her work, never in royalties, actual wages, or recording contracts. And I think this also explains a part of why not being able to perform curtailed Dolly's career so much, and why she wasn't able to reap the kind of benefits that we see for Miriam. Like I said, Dolly didn't actually even have any like recorded records of her music, and performing would have been her only way to achieve some sort of like income, and that wasn't a thing that could happen anymore. And I think it's also kind of sad how even for like present day South African artists, they still struggle with the fact that like music sales don't really bring in the kind of money they need, and people have to go perform so much. And all I gotta say is like, you guys gotta just keep making those TikToks. I'm sure we'll make it out of the hood eventually, like one day. Of course, Dorothy's music was also like heavily censored and banned, so I don't think there was much money to be made from it anyway. I don't think she was allowed to play on the record, on the radio, or like in movies and stuff. You know, like she was barely 20 years old when she had called out DF Milan, which is bold. And so, see you next Tuesday. I love it for her. In 2005, she would say, "I never held a gun, but my voice was as powerful as a gun." Dolly Rathebe passed away in 2004 from a stroke. Miriam followed in 2008, succumbing to a heart attack after performing Pata Pata in Italy. Dorothy was the last woman standing until she passed away in 2019 at the age of 83. Dear Count Bassie, I just found a jazz baby. She melts in my mouth like a jelly bean, boy. She was digging solid jazz drums and looking at me with eyes that made me feel like I was made of glass. She saw right into my heart and I confessed. Two things make me very weak, Count. Good jazz drums and a beautiful, beautiful face. Then I feel either like a beast or a wee little helpless mouse. I get caught in a dilemma, Count, by the beauty of jazz baby and the jazz of a beautiful baby. When she got hot at her drums, Count, she snapped a button on her yellow waistcoat. I picked it up and put it inside my pocket. If my wife asks, where shall I say I got it, Count? So this wasn't like an exhaustive, super, super detailed list of all of the influential women of South Africa, and especially those in the jazz age. There's a lot of women I haven't even discussed, but Dorothy, Dolly, and Miriam, I think, are probably the most influential, and they do have the most information available on them. And anyways, for me, it's been really great getting to know more about them and learning about their star power and their glamour, and getting to enter a world, a time and a place so far removed from my reality, yet so influential on it. Like, I can't imagine anything would exist as we know it right now without these women and their contributions. And I think the jazz age is really important to look at because it not only just coincides with the establishment of apartheid, but it was through jazz, art and literature that we sort of developed this culture of art where Black people were able to, as Dorothy Driver puts it, harness an energy that had not been harnessed by white authority yet. And I think it's really valuable to recognize how Black women were really crucial to that, that they built all of this. This didn't exist before them. And it's something to consider when we're deciding on the it girls of today, though I guess that's not really the kind of thing you can really see when you're in the moment. It's something that probably comes with hindsight. But I think from the records and what I've seen, it's pretty evident that these women dominated their present imagination as much as they dominate our imagination today. And that real star power is this ability to really encapsulate a time and a moment in a unique and a valuable and a powerful way, and to leave a legacy that lasts longer than just a beauty trend or just a really great look or saying something that will be memed for several years. Like, these women inspired entire generations of Black women following them, not only in the arts and in culture and music, but in the way Black women would come to see themselves and their identity formation. And that's a kind of effect that I think is probably more powerful than anything, which isn't obviously to say that like marching for rights isn't important, but I think all of these things had to exist with each other. I don't think one is necessarily possible without the other. Like, I don't think without having these visions of unambiguous Black women in this position of glamour would it have also enabled and empowered other African women to go protest and to collectivize and march for their rights. And if anything, I'd at least have been able to see some really pretty dresses and enjoy some really good music. As always, I look forward to hearing your thoughts, and I'm gonna do the really corny thing and ask you to smash that like button, hit subscribe, leave a comment below, and subscribe to my newsletter. As you know, I'm your girl, okay, Betty K, signing out. Sorry, I was thinking earlier about how much like all presenters these days like talk like that, like, hey, it's your girl B, you know, I'm calling you from MTV Raps, you whatever. And I just think it's so funny because I think that's 100% the influence of Bonang Mathebe, you know, one of the it girls I mentioned before. And I was just thinking about how much I would absolutely slit my throat if I spoke like that. But anyway, you can leave a like, you can subscribe, you can comment, or you don't have to. It's not the 50s, I'm not the cops, you're free to do whatever you want.